Last time we were looking at a gang of four pattern called the state pattern, and I implemented that for a pelican crossing, a pedestrian light control crossing, and used the state pattern to put that together. If you want to look at the previous video on that, have a look at that now, because I'm going to base this on the assumption that you're familiar with what we looked at there. But remember what we did there, just as a quick recap. If we look at the diagram here, we can see that was our state diagram, which didn't depend on the state pattern. This could be applied in many different ways, but we saw we had the six states that the pelican went through, and then we've got the class diagram, and we saw that the state pattern means we represent each state as an individual class. And then that was coded up looking something like this, where we had each one of those states. And when we run it up, we saw that as it moves through the states, things like green idle, green waiting, stopped, waiting to start, that sort of thing, then we saw it move through those. Now, although there's lots of benefits to the state pattern, if we have a look at each of these states, we'll notice there's a huge amount of similarity between them. And whenever you've got similarity, you want to think, is this something that could be more maintainable? Because although each one of our states does a different thing, it sets a different set of lights to on and flashing, it sets a particular timeout period, and then when we have the timeout or when the button's pressed, it moves on to a different state. They all do different things like that, but they all basically do those three things. They define the lights, they define the timeout, or occasionally there'll be no timeout at all, and then they define what state you should move on to when you're pressed or when the timeout's called. And because of that, we might be able to completely abstract this out and not have to have separate classes representing the individual states. And that's what this other pattern known as a finite state machine is all about. Now, it's a bit debated whether finite state machine is a pattern, because the term finite state machine is actually used in computer science to describe a particular simple type of computer, which is kind of one up from what's called a push-down automaton, which is then one up from a full-blown Turing machine. But also the term finite state machine was used for this design approach actually before design patterns were really invented. So this is a really old design pattern, so old that nobody really realized it was a design pattern, but I think it fits all the requirements for what we have as a design pattern, and so I'm going to call it that. And so what we're going to do here, I'm actually going to base this back on the original version with the switch statements, but we're going to get rid of them again, is we're going to introduce this idea of the finite state machine. So I've prepared some code here earlier, and what I've got to start with is this idea of a state item. And the state item is where we can, in a general purpose way, define all of that information that we had when we were looking at those individual state classes. So remember what I said, we had the state we're going to move on to when an action occurs. So that's next state. We had the timeout period, if any, so that's a nullable int, so it'll be null if we don't have a timeout. And then we had the lights that should be on and the lights that should be flashing. So we have an array here listing the lights that are going to be on and an array here listing the lights that are flashing. And we're going to assume all the other lights are going to be off. What we've also got in this is the current state and the action. So current state is obviously go idle, go waiting, and then the action is either going to be the press or the timeout. So in fact, any one of our state classes, if we look at, say, the prepare to start, that's really going to be represented by two of these state items, because we're going to have one state item with the current state of preparing to start and the action of timeout, and then another one for the press. So each of those functions is going to represent a different one of these objects. So we've got the current state, the action, and then the behavior when that action is carried out. Also, you'll notice I've put on here these JSON converters, because the real key to this finite state machine is it is data driven. So actually, in the end, we're going to see that all of the functionality is defined in this machine.json. So that is where we really define what's going on. So if we're in the go idle state and we have the press action, then we should move to go waiting. And then when we're in the go waiting state, we're going to have a subsequent timeout of 2 seconds, we're going to have those lights on. We're not going to have any lights flashing. So you can see each one of these defined in a JSON file. It doesn't have to be a JSON file. This could be stored in a database, stored in any format. The important thing is, though, the functionality is now no longer stored in code. And therefore, if we want to change the functionality, it's a configuration change. We don't have to write any code. We don't have to rebuild or anything like that. So that's what we're trying to achieve. And that's why I've just got these attributes. Basically, because these are enums, I want to be able to have those as text in my JSON file, not have them as just the numerical values. So that's what we've got there, our state item. And so what do we need to do with that? We need to incorporate that into our state machine. So there in our state machine, we've got our enums for the two actions and the six states. And then all we're going to do is we're going to create a two-dimensional array of those items. And this two-dimensional array is going to have one dimension of the action and another dimension of the current state. So depending on the current state, which we're storing there, when an action occurs, we simply look up for that current state, the appropriate state item for that action, and we process it. We need to have access to the Pelican. And you can also see we're taking in there the file name that we're going to use. We set up the Pelican, and then we initialize our array of state items to be 2x6, basically just using the enum values that we've got there. Then we need to populate that. So that's just some code I've commented out here. Let's put it in. So we get hold of the JSON file, which is what I just showed you, comes in the file name. We then use JSON deserialization to convert that into an array of state items. So this is only a one-dimensional array. And then this I'm actually going to have to write. So let's just generate a stub for that. And then what I have to do is take that item and find its place in the two-dimensional array. So I'm going to say underscore items, and then the first dimension is the action. So I'm going to say item.action. But bear in mind that's an enum, so we're going to have to cast it to an int for that. And then the second dimension is going to be the state. So item.currentState, and again, cast that to an int. And then that's where I'm simply going to put my item. So now that's taken that linear list of items and we've put them in the matrix. Notice there will be some empty fields in that matrix. There will be situations, if we look at the JSON, where, for example, go idle, although we have a press action, we saw last time, remember, when you're in the idle state, you should never be getting a timeout. In fact, there's only one state that can receive either, which is the prepare to start. And so on the prepare to start, you can see there we've got the press, and then there we've also got the timeout. So that will leave some blanks. We'll have to put a bit of safety code to check for that. What I then do is I set the current state to prepare to start. Now that's a bit of a cheat, because if you remember the diagram, we said our initial state is not prepare to start, our initial state is go idle. But the reason for that is, if I then fire off a timeout, then we can see that that will take us from prepare to start into go idle, and so that will get us into our initial state. But we've actually got to implement this action now, so again, let's do a bit of code generation, and we're just going to call that action. And so this is what's going to get called whenever something happens. So the first thing we've got to do is look up the appropriate state item. So we just say here state item, item equals, and then we're going to look it up in items. And so remember, the first dimension of items is action, and we've got to cast that to an int. And then the second one is state, which we stored in our current state, remember, that we set up there. And then we've got to actually deal with that. So the first thing we do, just like we did before, is we clear down all the lights. So remember, we've got our Pelican, so we're just going to say all off. That turns off all of the lights. Then we're going to say for each, and then we've got our enum of Pelican lights. So that's the red, the green, the amber, the weight, the green pedestrian, the red pedestrian. So we'll just call that L, and then in item dot, and first we'll do this for lights on. So that's the list of all the on lights. Again, we can see that there, for example. And then we'll say underscore pelican. Remember, pelican has an indexer to let us get at those. Dot state equals, and these are the on lights. So we're just going to set that to on. And then we'll do almost exactly the same thing. So this time in lights flashing, and we set them to flashing. So that's dealt with the lights. Then we've got to deal with the timeout. So here we're going to say underscore pelican.set timeout. And then again, just get the information off our selected item. So that was our timeout. That timeout, remember, was nullable. So we need to actually say if timeout doesn't equal null, and also put dot value on there. And then the third thing we had to do was actually move on to the next state. So now we simply say underscore current state, so we're keeping track of the state, equals item dot next state. So that's done all of that work, but in an entirely data-driven way. So we didn't hard code any of that like we did with the state pattern. We just let the data drive us. And then all we've got to really do there is just hook that back up to our Pelican. So remember, our Pelican at the moment is doing it with these big, horrible switch statements. So again, just like we could with the state pattern, we'll delete all of that. We will give our Pelican a state machine object. So private state machine underscore machine. We will actually get rid of the Pelican states again, because we don't need that, because remember, that's stored in the machine now. And then on our machine, we will say underscore machine equals new state machine. We need to pass in this, and we also need to pass in machine.json, because that was the name of our file. And then remember, the constructor for the state machine does that bit of initialization, so we don't need to do any of that anymore. And then our two methods, press and timeout, again, we can use the expression bodied member. We're simply going to say underscore machine dot, and I realize I made a mistake there, because this action actually has to be public, because that is accessible from the outside world. So machine dot action. And then because this is press, we just pass in the press enum. Get rid of that. And then on the timeout, almost exactly the same, except we pass in the timeout there. And if we run that, then we should see that it's behaving in the correct way. So it's going through the steps, nothing changed there. We can even do our re-request, and that will kick it off again before it's even finished. And more importantly, perhaps, we can go back to our unit tests. And our unit tests, once again, should give us green lights, because the behavior will be exactly the same for the state machine as it was for the state pattern, as it was for the simple implementation with the switch statements. So that's another way of doing the same job. Now, all three of the ways we had of solving that are examples of dealing with a stateful object. So the idea of having states, drawing the state diagram, that's common to all of them. What we've looked at is different implementations. The initial implementation with all the switch statements, I wouldn't touch that at all, that's horrible. Deciding between using a state machine and using a state pattern really comes down to the degree of similarity in the behavior of each one of our states. Remember, we looked back at this right at the beginning and said that when we had the state pattern, then each one of our states we could categorize it to be doing really exactly the same sort of thing, setting the lights, setting the timeout, moving on to the next state. And that's why it was something that we could turn into a state machine. If the different states in our state pattern were doing completely different things, required lots of complicated specific code, then that would be when the state pattern was the best way to go. But here, actually, I'd say overall, the state machine is the best way to go because it's now entirely data-driven. And we can see that. Remember what I showed you last time, the possible change we have in behavior. So some Pelican crossings in the UK, when they come out of red, they will flash to tell people that things are about to get going like that. We said that there are other situations where actually, although the green figure will flash, the red and the amber lights will stay on permanently. And we can now change that simply by changing the config file. So we want to find when we move into the prepare to start state. So that's going to be here where we've got the flashing lights. And we actually want to change that. So although the green figure is flashing, it's going to be the red and the amber lights that are on. And so if we run it through that, we should see the change in behavior. But the nice thing about that was that change in behavior was now entirely data driven. No rewriting of code, no recompilation of code. So you've got lots and lots of flexibility. And in fact, if you want to take this to an extreme, as well as just changing behavior within a particular state, you could change the entire structure of the diagram so you could have different states transiting to other states, and you can even, if you want to, add brand new states. Now, you couldn't quite do that here because our states have been predefined using an enum, but that's really just a convenience. Those now could simply have been strings rather than enums, and we could have made that work, and in that case, you could have added a new state purely in the configuration file. So that's really where the distinction is. When we're doing reconfiguration, do we want that to be something that can be done entirely data-driven through a file, like the JSON file or through a database, or do we want to do recoding? If we need to do recoding, use the state pattern. If we want to do configuration through a data source, then we use the finite state machine. Hope that was helpful. We'll be looking some more at this because actually there's a number of other patterns we can fit into this application. But for now, that was the state pattern. Hope you enjoyed that. Do remember to subscribe and look out for the next video.